The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, please shine down on me. Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, hiding behind a tree. These little children are asking you to please come out so we can play with you. Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, please shine down on me. Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, please shine down on me. Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, hiding behind a tree. These little children are asking you to please come out so we can play with you. Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, please shine down on, please shine down on, please shine down on me.
Cherry Street Magic here. We're actually visiting Defiance, Ohio, my hometown, and today it's a Johnny Appleseed Festival. It's about 2 weeks after our Johnny Appleseed Festival happened there in Fort Wayne, so you're going to be able to see what Johnny Appleseed's like in Defiance, so next year you could come out here and if you want to take a drive. And who do I have with me here?
I'm Trish Spicer. I'm the treasurer for Defiance County Historical Society, and we operate Auglaize Village.
Very good. And can you tell us what's going on here today?
There's a lot going on here today. So when you come out here, we've got vendors. We've got the railroad train operating that circles the village. You can take rides on the train. We've got food vendors. We have hit and miss engines. We've got sorghum demonstration, and you can take home some sorghum molasses afterwards. We've got cider being pressed. We have apple butter. Take home all of those things for a donation to the village. We've got weaving back in the lock keeper's cabin. We've got all of the village buildings are open today. We've got the State Historical Archaeological Association is here. They have a display and they will appraise your items for free today only. So plenty.
Trish,
I'm sure I've missed a lot.
Yeah, that's I'm sure. But Trish, how many years have you been doing this here in Defiance?
Well, this is, I think, the 53rd year
for
the Johnny Appleseed Festival out here.
Wow.
Yeah, the village
okay.
has been here over 50 years.
Do you have any people that come down from Fort Wayne, like
to visit?
Actually, in some of your booths. Probably do, don't you? Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure about Fort Wayne specifically.
But okay.
Lots of visitors from Fort Wayne, that's for sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Trish. Is there anything else you want to tell the people about maybe coming out next year if they miss it this year, huh?
It's a good, cheap way to entertain the family for the day, that's for sure. So
okay. We're
pretty happy with our festival. Yeah.
Thank you, Trish,
Thank
for
you.
Your help. Okay.
All Thank right.
you very much.
Yep.
Thanks.
Trish, you did a great
Thank
job.
You.
Thank you.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Well, Leslie, what do you think? You're on the train.
Not too bad. We had started, but...
Thank you.
arrowheads here. These are probably arrowheads we found right here in Fort Wayne, or right here in Defiance.
Some of them. And mostly Ohio pieces, if not. Hi there.
Yeah. We're from Fort Wayne.
Okay.
And so can you tell us about your arrowheads?
Sure. This is my collection from home, and some of them my grandfather found years ago, and I was lucky enough to get his collection, and I found some. My grandsons will keep finding them.
What's your name?
Bob Wilson.
Okay, Bob.
You
live in Defiance here?
Well, between Continental and Defiance, okay. Along Powell Creek. Of course, there's a lot of Indian history in this area because of the rivers.
Yeah.
Whether it be the Auglaize, the Maumee, or...
What type of Indians did we have here?
Well, when the last glacier left about 10,000 years ago, we had Paleo Indians.
Wow.
And then over the years, you know, things warmed up. They, instead of hunting the mastodons and the big animals, and they started hunting smaller animals and started doing a little farming. So, and I have some charts here that kind of illustrate that.
Some of the stuff we had was really more
some of the stuff that they planted and used as food, right?
Yes, that came along about the time they started making their own pottery and changed their lifestyle. Of course, the woolly mammoths became extinct shortly after they first started hunting them.
I'll tell you what, you've done some real studying here.
Well, thank you. Are you making a movie for what?
This is for Access TV.
Oh, good.
It's out of Fort Wayne, and there's about 80,000 people that could see it.
Good.
The reason we're here is we have a Johnny Appleseed in Fort Wayne.
I know you do.
And this is a Johnny Appleseed. We want to show people in Fort Wayne how they're missing out by not coming here, too.
Yes, and I've been to your one there at Fort Wayne. That's very impressive.
Well, good. I'm glad you like it.
I get there early so I can park close to it.
You're right. How long have you been collecting arrowheads?
Ever since I was this high walking out in the field, found my first one. I was hooked from then on. Yeah, that's just a great hobby. And it's a good way to be in touch with nature.
For people at home, how do you look for arrowheads?
Well, it's getting more difficult than it used to be because the change of farming practices, and you need to get permission to walk out on a farmer's field.
But, yeah.
But if you get a bare field, especially along a creek or a river, and you get out there and get to looking, even if you don't find a real arrowhead, you may find some broken flint, some evidence of the historic Indian or prehistoric Indians.
What does broken flint look like? Can you show us some of that? I wouldn't know what to look for now.
Yes.
Is that like flint and steel, how they make fires?
Well, no, the flint chips, you know, when the Indians would break a rock to make an arrowhead,
okay.
Some of the little pieces that broke off that rock became chips, and
okay.
Some of the nice sharper ones they'd use for a little knife for a while.
For actually skinning animals and things?
Yeah.
Wow.
And so the evidence for an Indian village site would be not only an arrowhead, but also the broken rocks, the broken flint that was left after they made their arrowhead.
Maybe even some pottery, huh?
And the later, we're going back 500 to 3,000 years ago, you'd find pottery sherds, if they're still around. Now, it seems like around here in this heavy clay soil, the pottery sherds are pretty scarce around here. Mm-hmm. If you get into the sandy soil slopes, the stuff preserves better, and you find more pottery.
Can you tell us, since you're such a historian here, we had a historical site here in our library called the Battle of the Fallen Timbers, correct?
Right.
Can you tell us a little bit about that? For people who don't know about the Battle of Fallen Timbers.
Well, of course, that was when that was the third time we tried to defeat the Indians in the late 1700s. Mad Anthony Wayne came up.
Fort Wayne?
Well, he came up from Cincinnati, built a string of forts. He built Fort Wayne, he built Fort Defiance, and then he defeated the Indians, the Battle of Fallen Timbers up towards Waterville.
Okay.
Yeah, we celebrate that this every year. Let's see, we had the 200-year celebration back in 1994.
Okay.
Now we're coming up on the 225th year. So we have activities right here at Fort Defiance.
And if you want to read about some of that, you go to the Defiance Library downtown, and you'll see signs up that explains all about that. And you get, even got some of the original paintings there. So Defiance is a nice historical town to visit.
Yeah, rich in history,
mm-hmm.
and it's more than likely because of the rivers all coming together. The Maumee River, of course, comes from Fort Wayne.
Yeah, isn't that like the Maumee, the only north flowing river or something like that? Than the Mississippi or something like that?
You know, that's interesting. The rivers all come together over Fort Wayne also. It's
yeah.
The, what is it, the St. Joe and
St. Mary's?
St.
Mary's near Maumee?
Yeah.
Then the Maumee comes down here.
Yeah. And then down here we pick up the Tiffin River coming from the north. We pick up the Auglaize coming from the southwest.
Do you know how they named the Auglaize?
Auglaize. Well, I'm sure it was an Indian term.
Yeah, what happened is some donuts fell in the water. And they picked them up and they said, oh, all glaives. Oh, that's not how it worked, is it? No.
I know, babe. That's an Indian term. Something, it might have something to do with buffalo being in the water. I don't remember exactly.
Oh, really? I would never have thought that. That's,
yeah.
You're an interesting guy to talk to, let me tell you.
Yes, and now. But you know, Johnny Appleseed is standing right over here. He's more interesting than I am.
All right.
The Johnny Appleseed from Defiance.
We'll have to see him. Yes.
And also, I have what we call the Three Rivers Trade Act over there.
Okay.
It's supposed to be from the Fort Wayne area.
Okay.
I probably should put that on you. So,
all right.
Before you leave, I'll meet you over on that side of the table.
All right. We'll talk to Johnny here and then meet you over there.
Great.
Okay. Yes. This is Johnny Appleseed here, right? Yes.
Lou.
Johnny, can you tell us what's going on here today and why the big festival? I know it's about you. Yes.
Well, I don't know why it's about me, to tell you the truth. I'm just, you know, a simple person that just out to sell some apple trees.
Okay.
Now if you need some apple trees, you let me know.
How did that come about where you got famous for apple trees?
Well, you see, a man's got to make a living.
Uh-huh.
And I would sell my apple trees or take a note for an apple tree. And I sold my apple trees for 3 cents a piece.
Wow. Okay.
Unless you wanted me to plant it, and then it was six.
Okay.
And most folk, well, they would buy at least 50 trees. Because you see, at that time, in order to keep your land, if you bought it from the government, well, you, within 5 years of setting your cabin, you had to have an orchard of at least 50 trees that were producing.
Oh, is that called improving the land?
Yeah. Okay. And so once you set your cabin, you had to have some acreage tilled up so that you could have corn and beans and such. And then you had to have at least 50 trees producing apples or peaches or such. And so people would need to buy trees for me, because if you plant a seed, well, it takes 5 to 6 years for a tree, an apple tree, to start producing.
Did you have any particular type of apples?
Whatever God gave you, that's the apple tree you got. Now, there are some folk that like to do grafting, but I was never one for that.
Okay.
I was just, you plant the tree, and if it grows and God gives you a good apple,
and
then you got a good apple.
Where did you get all your saplings or plant to give to people? Where'd you get them all?
Well, I started out, I had some friends in Pennsylvania that I would go to that had apple trees. And so I would get their leavings. If you get a chance, when down here where they make the cider, you'll see there's a wagon there that has a whole bunch of the leavings of the apples from making cider. And so I'd sort through it and get my seeds for free.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you didn't have to pay for it.
So if you eat an apple, you can actually use those seeds.
Yes, sir. Yes.
God made those seeds to actually grow.
But you don't know what you're going to get. Because you see, an apple, well, you plant a seed and you might get the same kind of apple or you might get a different one.
How could that be?
Because that's the type of plant that it is.
Ah.
It's the type of plant that you cannot make a hybrid.
I didn't know that.
Nope, that's why most folk, they went to the grafts. Because if they found an apple they liked, they would then take the cutting and then grafted onto the root system of another apple tree.
Okay, I didn't know that. Yes. So you plant it and you get that I'm learning a lot about apples from you.
No, in fact, if you look at worldwide of all the apples, now apples came originally from a place called near Afghanistan. Well, if you look worldwide, there's approximately 23,000, somewhere in there, a lot of different types of apples.
Wow.
Yeah. And then in the United States, there's about, I'd say, if you include all the heritage apples and everything, there's about 1,500 varieties of apples being grown here in the States.
Now, in a grocery store, there's only about 3 or 4 varieties.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And that would be like Jonathan?
Yes, sir. Yeah, and Macintosh and the Galas and the Honeycrisp and those are all different trees that grew up and people liked them. Mm-hmm. And so they made grafts to spread them out. If you've ever had an apple called Grimes Golden.
Never have.
Oh, well, that one started over in what you call West Virginia. At the time it was Virginia, near Wellsville, I think it's called. And there was a man by the name of John Grimes that I planted some trees for him, and he liked those. And so he made grafts from that one tree, and he got his golden Grimes Golden. Yeah.
So. Johnny, is there anything else you want to tell the people about?
Well, if you get a chance, you come on down over here tomorrow too, and see me. If you can't come, well, there's always the Johnny Appleseed Festival in Fort Wayne in September.
When's your Johnny Appleseed? In case they miss it this year, every year about what time?
Well, I do believe it is always in Fort Wayne. It is always
here.
It is always the first weekend in October.
First weekend in October.
First weekend in October. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
But this is a really nice place out here.
I enjoy it. It's fun. Yeah. I enjoy visiting with people and talking and such. So.
Yeah, Johnny, you have a lot of information. Man.
Oh,
you really
well,
do about your life. Yeah?
Yes, well, I enjoy it. You know, it's hard for me to stay in one spot for a long time. So if you do see me out and about, well, you make sure that you give a shout and say hi to me. Because you never know where I show up. I'm all over.
Okay, Johnny, thank you so much.
Oh, you are welcome, and thank you for talking to me.
That was a wonderful interview. You did very well.
Oh, thank you.
You did very well. It is. Is that a real blacksmith back here? Are you a blacksmith?
Nope. I'm an apprentice and knows just enough to get in trouble.
Okay. But you know enough to pump in the air in there.
Yep.
Tell us what you're doing here.
I am forging a heart. Right now I'm getting ready to put the little curvature up at the top of the heart.
Okay.
Since finishing out the whatever the heart conventional shape is going to be a bit more tedious.
When you pump that air in there, it makes it hotter?
Yes.
Okay. How hot does it have to be for it bends?
For mild steel, you want it to be close and almost white, which if I'm correct off the top of my head, that's gonna be around maybe near from 1600 to 1800 degrees.
Okay, 1600 to 1800.
That's my guess.
Okay. How do you keep from getting burnt? You get burnt sometimes?
Sometimes, yes.
Yeah. What's your name?
Andrew? Yes.
Okay. Just like on the back.
Sure. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, we're watching here. Be careful, Andrew. Look at that. Definitely not easy being a blacksmith. many times have you heated that up, Andrew?
Probably, at this point, I have lost count. What?
Okay, about three or four times already? I mean, you know, to make it that shape.
This is my first time trying to make it. This is my first time trying to make it hard. It'll probably be
okay.
A lot more times.
Yeah. I'm very proud of you for having confidence enough to do it. I don't think I could have that much confidence. Who taught you how to do this? Who taught you, Andrew? Who taught you?
The actual blacksmith out of the village? Who? They don't really tell me, but they show me enough. I'd say if I'm really strong with something, go, come and, hey, this is how you do that.
Okay.
Like earlier, I was being a bit too rough with the bellows here. On the roll here, it's like, you need more gentle with it, so.
Okay.
Essentially make sure I stay out of trouble, but generally everything I learn myself at my own pace.
Okay. So it's going to probably take you most of the day to make this hard, if not more, huh?
Probably, yes. And for a professional blacksmith, for some of the stuff they make, it's not uncommon for them to take weeks to make something. So.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Andrew, for showing us. Not very often we get to see somebody hammering on a red-hot piece of metal. Okay, thanks again.
Yep.
Getting all the way up. This is a illusion that only about five magicians in the world I know of that do. Okay, this one. And now I'll just take it in the middle here. Okay. Are you familiar with Harry Potter? Okay. In Harry Potter, there's a bird that's called a phoenix. Do you remember the illusion or what it is? The phoenix does. Okay. The bird, the phoenix, what it actually does is it doesn't really die, okay, in Harry Potter. It burns itself up and renews itself and becomes a brand new bird. Okay, what I'm going to do is have you just take this and just light the tip of this thing. Ooh, wow, it's got a bigger flame than I thought. Okay. Okay, very good. See, it's a little hot yet. Hold your hand off this. I'm going to put this in your hand. Okay? Try not to burn. Okay? Okay, you don't want to burn. Okay. Put this in here like this. Okay. Now, I'm going to find something like a magic wand. I'll just use this. Okay. We're going to try to renew this napkin. Like the phoenix, okay? Do you know any magic beads?
What? Magic
beads? Do you know magic beads?
Oh, hocus pocus.
Hocus pocus, that's a really good one. I'll wave the magic wand, you say?
Hocus pocus.
Okay, slowly release your hand.
Sharp.
Huh. That was your napkin.
That was me. I'll never know how you did that, but...
This one's a little more difficult, but that's why a lot of magicians don't do that one.
Right. So.
Old MacDonald had a farm,
E-I-E-I-O.
And on his farm he had a cow,
E-I-E-I-O.
There,
quack, there, quack,
everywhere a quack, quack.
Old MacDonald had a farm.
Baba.
Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O.
Old MacDonald had a farm,
E-I-E-I-O.
And on his farm he had some chickens,
E-I-E-I-O.
With a cluck-cluck here and a cluck-cluck there.
Here, cluck, there, cluck, everywhere, cluck, cluck.
And a baba here and a baba there.
It does. It makes sorghum molasses. We're from Fort Wayne, and we're finding out what's going on here at the Johnny Appleseed. Are you making the sorghum molasses? What is sorghum molasses? First, what's your name?
You ever hear of sorghum cookies?
Yeah? Same stuff. Okay. I heard it like sorghum. It kind of makes your mouth pucker.
Yeah.
But that's about all I know about it. What's sorghum made from? Oh, okay, it's like a sugar cane. That's sorghum, huh?
Sorghum, I like corn, but I don't have beer.
Oh, okay. Sorghum. Wow. You're coming to see, or you're coming to see?
Volunteer or all the seed we had last year.
All by itself.
Yeah.
So, wow. It's got to let a little tussle up there or something.
That's the seed. That's the seed.
That's the seed. Okay. Wow. Can you tell us what's going on over here? Is it grinding it or what?
Oh, they're making apples. Apples are grinding.
Oh, you smell right here?
A half a mile away, you can hear them pop, 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 pop.
Yeah.
We always call them Johnny Poppers.
Oh, okay.
So this particular
cylinder.
This is just one.
One cylinder.
And it's bigger than this. It's a McCormick. And okay. This is a spark plug model.
Oh, okay.
A lot of them are not spark plugs. Actually, if you go around there and corner the two trailer loads, you'll get more information. Those guys are almost experts on these.
Okay.
I always wanted one, so this is the only one I have.
It looks like it's quite economical to run, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. They run all day, and they're using very little fuel.
Wow.
You know, we're using one on the cider press here today, which is quite a bit bigger. We've used that same one for years, but...
What did they use these for back then? Like
different kinds of things. Shell corn and grind corn. They'll run bigger ones and run a sawmill.
Oh, okay.
I mean, they had so many applications and there's literally hundreds of these motors. I mean, you'd think you'd heard them all. There's one called a Tom Dom. I mean, the list just goes on and on.
Okay.
If you talk to Johnny and Frank over there, they'd probably give you a list of... one guy's got 40 engines himself.
Okay.
And the other guy's got the tractor, that real old case tractor there.
Yeah.
But
thank you so much. How long have you owned this one?
Oh, probably about 5 years. But I bought it from another young guy over by Holgate, Ohio. He's got... This guy's... not even 40 years old and he don't have a job. That's all he does is buy and pedal these motors.
Okay.
And he goes all over the country and buys collections. He turns around and sells them. And I used to see him every time I see him, I said, did you get a job yet? He said, I don't have time. But he's made a fortune.
Yeah.
He's made a small fortune by being a hobby and a good income.
Right. Thank you so much.
All right.
So glad you brought that to see. Thank you very much.
If you got the time, wander over and talk to those two guys. They'll give you a lot more information than what I do.
Well, that's okay. You gave us a lot there. Thanks a lot.
All right.
Thank you. Need a haircut, Wesley?
I need to go get one.
You need to go get one. This might be a good place to get one. It's called a barbershop. Are you the barber?
I'm not actually a barber.
Okay.
I just talk about it.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Tell us a little bit about that barber shop.
Well, this is a one.
What's your name?
My name's Craig Furness.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Craig.
Okay, Craig.
And this is a one-chair barber shop. It was in a very small town, and so didn't need a lot of room. Men would obviously come in here to get a haircut, maybe a shave. But it's also a gathering place sort of a thing.
Yeah.
Sit in the chairs and the bench there and talk about each other and sort of catch up with each other and sort of solve all the problems of the world in here. Yeah. Until you had to go back out. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's what we got.
Back in the days, that's a barber really had to be somebody very personable.
Oh, absolutely, yes. Absolutely, yeah.
If you weren't, you couldn't.
And had to be able to talk to people of all sorts of ranges. Yeah, exactly.
And not be discriminatory with anybody.
Yeah, nope. You agreed with just about everything you heard. And, and you just went on from there. But it was, it was a place, where they could come together and sort of catch up on things. Maybe they're playing checkers over here or a card game over there. Like I say, it was a man cave kind of a thing for its
like
day.
Like these little two old ladies were talking. One of the little lady said, well, tell me more. And the other one said, well, I told you more and I heard already.
that was probably going on here too. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep, talking about the one that got away and all that stuff.
Oh, yes.
Absolutely. Yep.
Very good.
Yeah.
Are you from Defiance?
Yeah.
Great, good.
Yep. And what about you guys?
I'm actually from Defiance. My brother was the mayor. I'm Jerry Armstrong.
Oh, okay.
Bob.
Yeah.
Yep. So I just met the mayor of Defiance over here.
Oh, is he here?
Here.
I didn't know he was here.
He's here. He's over there making apple.
Oh, okay.
Apple butter.
I didn't know he had that skill about him.
He does. He's got a lot of skills. He does.
Oh, that's good.
That's good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
thank you.
Good to see you. Thanks for coming.
Where'd you work? Did you work here in Fort Worth in Defiance, I mean?
I retired from Defiance Metal, yeah.
A metal, okay. Yeah. Very good. Mm-hmm. I've lived here all my life. Defiance Metal.
Defiance Metal Products, DMP.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yep, I know right where it's at. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Good job.
Good
nice to meet you.
Yeah, good to meet
you. This is a really unique ice cream shop. What do you call it?
We call it Ugliest Village Ice Cream Shop.
Okay.
And our theme is red, blue, and white.
Uh-huh.
As you look around the room, you'll see red, blue, and white.
Very patriotic, yes. Yes, yes.
And
what's your name?
My name's Chris Rath, and this is my granddaughter, Shaylee Miller.
Oh, hi, Shaylee.
And my daughter, Sharissa Miller.
Oh, okay.
And we're all volunteering out here, serving ice cream, apple crisp, and chocolate pecan brownies with homemade sauces.
Tell you what, you're still open tomorrow, aren't you?
Yes, tomorrow from 10 to 4.
Okay, excellent. Anyone who missed it this year, come on out to Auguries Village next year with Johnny Appleseed and have their ice cream and brownies, and there's so much good things out here.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Anything you want to say to the people in Fort Wayne?
Good food, great time. Come on down.
I love that. Thank you.
Spartan.
You ready? Okay. We have straw brooms. I never knew how they were made. What's your name?
My name's Foyle Soleather. I'm the broom maker here.
All right, can you tell us how these brooms are made?
Well, we start over here at the broom winder.
Uh-huh.
And we put the handle into the boom, the chuck, and get it chucked down.
Uh-huh.
And then we proceed to put layer after layer of broom corn.
Okay, on broom
it.
Corn.
Broom corn, yes.
Okay, so that's actually from corn stalks.
Corn stalks, yeah. It grows like this.
Okay.
And it's a derivative of the sorghum. If you the sorghum molasses. Yes. Yeah. It's the same family, same variety. It's just that the broom corn has a bigger flume to it. And it's not sweet, so you don't make molasses out of it.
Yeah.
So, but it's so everything comes from the broom corn.
Okay. And that's actually on a stalk of corn, huh?
Stalk of corn, yeah. This is just the top of it, but they grow about this tall.
Usually I see the other stuff, like other things up there. But
the tassels, yeah.
Tassels, yeah.
Well, this is a variety that's made just specifically for brooms.
Oh, okay.
That's
okay.
All it's groomed.
It's not the kind you see in the field.
No.
Okay,
specifically.
Kind.
Okay. After we layer it and get a good broom, this one here is just about finished.
Okay.
We then stitch it, and we just use the sewing needle.
Uh-huh.
And do an over and under stitch.
It takes a long time to get one broom.
Yep. And then to finish it, we'll put a little knot in it. That'll hold the string in. And we'll get that knot in there nice and tight.
That's not coming out. What an art. Where'd you learn this art of doing this?
I took a class.
Did you?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. And this is the actual one they had back then of holding the grooms together?
Mm-hmm. Well, mine are a little more artistic because I put the colored broom on them, and this is the natural.
No, I mean this thing here holding it.
Oh, yeah. That's that bundles it together so that it... we'll stay together.
Okay.
And then once we're done here, we take it over to the chopper, and this is the cutter.
Okay.
This is an old broom I'm just demonstrating.
All right.
and that cuts it off flat.
Yep.
And my knife is a little sharp, or a little dull, but.
Finishing touches.
Yes.
Nice.
So, and then that's the clean broom.
So which is ready to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I usually tell anybody that if they can fly it around the barn, it's free. And then if I've done it right.
Okay.
Wow, isn't that pretty?
It stands up on
its
own.
Stand on its own.
Wow. You can cut it. Right?
There it is.
Wow.
That's perfectly balanced. Hi, Wes.
Yes.
Hi. So.
And when did they first start making these lights?
I know the shakers started making flat brooms. Prior to that, they were all round. And that was probably in the 1800s sometime.
Okay. 1800s. So.
Yeah, I'm going back when you're done.
Thank you so much.
Uh-huh.
You're quite knowledgeable.
Thank you.
You are.
Thank have a good day.
You have
a good
day.
Uh-huh.
What's your name?
My name is Linda Wagner.
Linda, okay.
And I've only ran the store for 3 years.
Okay.
The lady before had to give it up. All the buildings, and I mean this too, all the buildings here are original buildings from other areas brought in.
Okay.
And I don't know, we have a lot of older stuff here for people to look at, but I also sell candy for the kids.
Mm-hmm.
I sell cookbooks, hats, shirts.
Okay. And this is called Auglaize Village.
Village. Mm-hmm.
Yes. In Defiance, Ohio.
Correct.
And is it open most of the time?
No. We have 4 shows a year,
mm-hmm.
but now every Tuesday, there's 8 men out here that do fixing up or repair things.
Okay.
And anybody can come out then and take a tour.
Okay.
And yes. On first Saturday of every month in the morning.
Okay.
So,
good.
Welcome to come anytime.
And those are toy guns, huh?
Yes, they are. That's toy guns.
Okay.
We don't have the real guns.
Real, yeah.
But we do have real ammunition,
yeah.
Which is very old.
Yeah,
very old.
Nice thing about ammunition, it lasts.
Yes, yes.
You still fire after many years.
Yes.
So
we love it all.
I actually remember seeing a paper wrapper like that.
Oh yeah.
Yes. Used to wrap things. Yeah.
And there's the twine to put around.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Once it's wrapped.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay. Everything. I'm going to shut this up.
How do you make the apple? First, what's your name?
Lynn. Lance.
Lynn Lance.
Yeah, okay. I'm the mayor here.
Oh, you're the mayor.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm Bob Armstrong's brother.
Sharon has a picture of me sitting in that barber chair,
uh-huh.
and he cutting my hair.
Oh, yeah? He loves to cut hair.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got a big chair in his house. He's never going to stop being a barber,
yeah.
So he loves that.
Well,
so,
we start out with 15 gallons of cider.
Right.
In a copper kettle. You boil that down till it's half gone. Then you put 15 gallons of prepared apple. That's cored
mm-hmm.
and skin off.
Okay.
You cook that till it's half gone. Then you put in cinnamon, allspice, and clove. And you, once that's blended in, it takes about a half hour. Then you can put sugar in it, white sugar and brown sugar. And it takes another half hour to get that all blended in.
That's quite a process. Yeah.
It's a minimum of 16 hours.
Wow.
And it's nonstop.
Yeah, you can't stop in the middle
no.
of it. You have to keep going. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so interesting. I have to get some of that before I leave here.
That up there I made yesterday.
Did you? Okay, I'll get me some of that. Thanks a lot. Okay.
But alone anymore.
Right.
Even a younger person should not go out alone. You don't know what could happen.
You're right. But in a kayak, you can't take anybody, can you?
Well, they have tandems. Oh. They have some that'll hold two, okay. and even three.
So you actually kayaked yourself?
Yeah, I've gone out a lot by myself. I shouldn't have.
Have you ever learned how to flip one back?
No, right, but I got thrown out of mine accidentally on the Blanchard River. Uh-huh. I got thrown in about 3 foot of water. I can't swim. Ooh. My life jacket kept my head above water.
That's quite a story, I tell you. I'm glad you're here to tell us about it.
I like to be on the water, but not in it.
Okay. Have you been married before?
Five times.
Five times? That was a
I've had my first wife committed suicide 2 weeks after a baby girl was born. I've lost two wives to cancer. Oh. I've had a divorce. I've had two cancer surgeries, and I'm dealing with more of it.
Yeah. But I tell you what, for 90, how old?
90.
Wow, you're doing very well.
That was a healthy job, being a city mail carrier. not so good with the bad weather, the dogs, but you're supposed to have 150 minutes of exercise a week. Yep. Too many people are not doing it.
No, you're exactly right. You're exactly right.
You got to stay active.
Yep. Yeah.
Didn't you used to be in cardiology?
Yes.
I thought so.
I did. But I'm retired now.
We've got a Dr. Ollie there. Uh-huh. Now we've got a Dr. Ollie in cardio.
We pump the water by using the wind. As that turbine would turn, it would actually automatically pump, and then water would move into this trough to where animals could drink out of it. Isn't that something?
It is.
Yeah. And it's kind of hard to control how fast it's running. So see that cup at the end of the pump over there? The cup will hold a little bit, so let the water go through the pipe. So they actually have an anchor to hold down the windmill so it won't be turning. See how the anchor's hanging? That's heavy enough. That anchor probably weighs 150 pounds or more. That keeps the wind from turning the mill at this time. So, yep, and there's an actual water spigot there. Okay. These cabooses have now been replaced by a light on the back of the train. And they call that light on the back of the train a Ralph. Did you know that?
And they call it Ralph.
At one time, it used to take seven people to actually run a train. It took a fireman, a conductor, seven different people. Besides the engineer. So nowadays, it only takes one person to run a train, and he is a combination conductor and engineer.
We got seats up here.
Uh-huh. That's so they can actually look out the back and see what's coming from behind them. So.
What's in here?
Yep. Wow. You always wonder what that little roof was on top of the caboose.
And stove.
That's what that is.
Mm-hmm. This is cool. This is where they live. Like their bedroom.
Yeah. The lady is right. This is the bed. No, this is where they can sleep.
Mm-hmm. Oh my.
Sometimes if they're on a train for maybe a week. So. Uh-huh. Here's the Auglaize fire station. Let's take a look at these old fire trucks. They actually have one in here that's horse pulled. This is a horse pulled, this one. So,
oh, wow.
Isn't that something?
Sherwood Fire Department, this actually was an actual Sherwood fire tanker that carried the water. Yep, and then they built up steam so it would actually pump the water up. And even had the fire buckets to throw the water.
Where does the people go on it?
What?
Where did the people sit?
Oh, up here.
Oh.
They sit up here. Two people sit up here, put their feet on the hoses down in this thing here. See this wheel here? This is what rings out the hoses.
Oh, that's neat. It
gets all the water out of the hoses.
And here's another fire plug.
Mm-hmm.
The old one.
Yep. Chevrolet.
1947. Wow.
Year I was born. So
that's as old as you are.
Yes, as old as me, as I am. Man, that's old. Whoops. Take a look at the inside here. All the knobs. Okay, there's the hot nozzle. Alright, oh, look at this. This is where I actually had a post office. You come here and stand here and say, hey, do I have any mail? Look for yourself. See, you have any in your box? No, then you don't have any mail. If you got mail, it'd be in your box. Okay, okay. So,
you do your money orders here.
Okay. Yep. I don't think they delivered the mail years and years ago. You had to come to the post.
You don't feel the heat.
Yeah, it's warmer in here, isn't it? So they don't have a heater on. I think it's just a... It's kept the heat in here, I think. Okay.
Out of apples or is there something else?
Basically apples, yeah.
Is it?
We
okay.
use cider in there, you boil it down.
Okay.
You put in the apples. Then there's sugar and spices added later.
All right.
We do put in the spices first because we do make some that is sugar-free.
Oh, okay.
We jar a few jars sugar-free first, and then the last thing we put in is sugar.
Okay. This is pretty...
been out here quite a few years, or is this your first year?
I've been out here 5 or 6 years.
Okay.
He's been out here like forever.
All right, okay.
I'm his second wife.
Oh, okay.
His first wife passed away, my husband passed away, and we got together.
He's been
coming out here like forever.
He worked here so hard, and they make an apple butter, and now you're taking over.
Yep. Yep, that's right.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you.
This is where I got my tickets for Wesley and I. Look at them. They look like almost authentic tickets. You know, they made a lot like the original
yes.
tickets.
And they just punch a hole in it so you can keep it as a souvenir.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. And what's your name?
Sandra Kogan. My husband and I both volunteer. He's the conductor on the train.
All right. Very good. Good.
Thank you.
So is this your first year for doing it?
The first year for working here, yeah.
Okay.
I just retired this year. He's retired three years, so we decided we'd try.
This is really nice.
Yeah, we've been here a couple different years.
Anything
but,
you can tell us about the train?
Not really. I don't know that much about it. You can ask the driver when they pull up. He'll tell you about it. He's been here for a while.
Thank you so much.
Frederick.